Thank you all very much for coming tonight. Welcome to the fourth biennial Boston Neighborhood City Councilor-at-Large Candidates Forum. Somebody asked me what biennial was, and I said it's every 2 years, not twice a year. So actually, this is the eighth year we've done this, so it's the fourth time, but the eighth year. And the Park Street School has been great, and we thank them very much for allowing us the use of their auditorium. The event is co-sponsored tonight by 10 Boston neighborhood organizations. We have these great posters, one's here and one's in the back, which were donated by Icon Document Services, and we thank them very much for donating those as well. The organizations are the Beacon Hill Civic Association, the Neighborhood Association of Back Bay, the West End Civic Association, the North End Waterfront Residents Association, the Bay Village Neighborhood Association, the Fenway Civic Association, Ellis South End Neighborhood Association, Union Park Neighborhood Association, 8th Streets Neighborhood Association, and the Blackstone Franklin Square Neighborhood Association. Many of these groups have been with us for all 8 years, and we have a few new ones. Our moderator this evening is Peter Nesson, who will be right over here today. Also wanted to recognize Marty Wall, state representative, who's here as well tonight. The City Council is a legislative body for the City of Boston. It serves as the link between the citizens of Boston and their municipal government. Through the filing of legislation, the enactment of orders and ordinances and resolutions, the Council effectively represents the diverse interests of Bostonians while ensuring the efficient and cost-effective delivery of services. The Council fulfills its obligation as the appropriating authority by analyzing appropriations and loan orders. The Boston City Council is the legislative branch of government for the City of Boston. It is made up of 13 members, 9 district representatives, and 4 at-large members. Councilors are elected to 2-year terms, and there is no limit. On terms that an individual can serve. The Council is responsible for approving the city budget, monitoring, creating, and abolishing city agencies, making land use decisions, and approving, amending, and rejecting other legislative proposals. Prior to 1909, Boston's legislative body consisted of an 8-member board of aldermen and a common council made up of 3 representatives from each of the 25 wards of the city. So it was quite a large legislative body. When the Boston City Charter was rewritten in 1909, the Board of Aldermen and the Common Council were replaced by a 9-member City Council. All 9 councilors were elected at large for terms lasting 2 years. The new charter also gave the mayor the power to veto all acts of the City Council. The first council meeting as a unicameral body occurred on February 7, 1910. In November of 1981, Boston voters approved a change in the composition of the council to 13 members, 9 district members, and 4 at-large members. However, the referendum did not indicate how the district lines would be drawn, only that the districts be of approximately equal population, and that district lines not cut across city precincts. Since then, they've been changed here and there over time. The City Council's chambers are in Boston City Hall. A majority vote of 7-6 is necessary to elect a councilor to president. When the mayor traveled out of state or was removed from office, the City Council president serves as the acting mayor. In fact, that's how our own Mayor Nino became mayor originally, was being elevated from City Council president.
Bob, I want you to know I encourage him to travel as often as
he can. I know you do. Yeah. Councilor Murphy is the current City Council president. The format of the forum tonight will be as follows. There will be no opening statements. Each candidate will answer a series of questions directed to the candidates as a group. Each candidate. The questions to be asked to the candidates have been drawn from a group of questions that have been previously provided to the candidates. Each candidate will answer the same question with up to 1 minute given to each candidate to answer. The 7 candidates for Boston City Councilor at Large are Felix Arroyo, who is here, great. John Connolly, Will Dorcena, Michael Flaherty, Stephen Murphy, Ayanna Pressley, and Sean Ryan at the end. They're seated on the table on alphabetical order. And the first question will be determined by lot. Thus, the candidate chosen by lot would start off by being the first person to answer the first question. And the next question thereafter would be fielded to the candidate that falls alphabetically immediately after the candidate chosen by lot and so forth. We'll end the event with 2 minutes of closing remarks from each candidate, with the order of closing remarks be determined by lot. Forum will last up to 90 minutes. If need be, the moderator, Peter Nesson, may limit the time the candidates will have to respond to questions and to give closing statements. In his discretion, the moderator will also ask a follow-up questions or rebuttal opportunity if he deems it appropriate. For the fourth time in 8 years, our moderator again is Peter Nesson. For more than four decades of experience, and he has more than four decades of experience in public and private finance. He's the founder and president of Nesson Associates, a public accountant who served as chief executive officer and on the governing board of advisors for national investment firms. From 1987 to 1990, he was the assistant secretary of administrative and finance, responsible for human and social service purchase reform. From 1991 to 1993, he was secretary of the executive office of administration and finance for the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. He has chaired the Massachusetts Cultural Council and served on the Governor's Commission evaluating school reform. He holds a BA degree from Dartmouth College and a master's in business administration from Dartmouth's Amos Tuck Graduate School. He's a dedicated and passionate public policy advocate who currently serves on the boards of numerous for-profit and non-profit organizations. And he's the founder and chair of a public policy organization that provides services to not-for-profit, healthcare, and other organizations. Along with his wife Beatrice, he's a longtime resident of Beacon Hill and a good friend. I now present to you Peter Nesson.
Thank you all for being here, and I look at what I would deem the Magnificent Seven. Thank you very much. Let me go right. I need to draw the first person, and that will be, here it is right here. That is, okay, there. Is Stephen Murphy. So we will move down toward me, and then we will go up to Felix to respond and continue down, and the next question would go to Ms. Pressley. The first question, and this would be answered by each one of you for 1 minute, and I have a timekeeper right in the front who I can't see, but she is instructed to say stop when your minute's up, and I will enforce the stop. Thank you. The first question to be answered is, there are only four at-large Boston City Councilors who represent the entire city of Boston and all its neighborhoods. Of the candidates now running for these four seats, what makes you stand out from the other candidates, and what would your priorities be during the first 6 months in office, and why? And if that's not a loaded question, in addition, I ask you, in your response, please also tell us why you are running for this office.
All in a minute?
All in a minute.
I have to talk like an auctioneer. Thank you, Peter. Good evening, everybody. As you know, or you may know, I've been the City Council President for the past 10 months, and we've had a very productive focused year where we've worked together and tried to make a difference in the quality of life of the neighborhoods of Boston. It isn't just individuals and families that are impacted by a down economy. Cities are as well. And I bring a wealth of experience in business and finance to this job. As Peter has a background in business and finance, so do I. I'm familiar with the bond market. I'm familiar with public financing. I've been able to change the payment in lieu of taxes formula with the help of my colleagues and the mayor to increase revenue by $30 million over the next few years. I found a $26 million savings in refinancing our bonds this year. So that together totals about $58 million. And that's it. Thank you.
All right. Good evening. Thank you all for being here. My name is Ayanna Pressley. I'm asking for 1 year for votes November 8th and your endorsement this evening. I believe I've brought a different perspective to the council, my strength of advocacy for issues uniquely impacting women and girls, ranging from teen pregnancy, the number one reason our girls drop out of school, human trafficking, domestic violence, sexual assault, looking to eliminate barriers for female entrepreneurs, and also challenging gender role stereotypes by advocating for more women in police and fire in the building trades. I also believe that I'm working on issues that typically have not been seen as germane to municipal government, such as eradicating poverty and cycles of violence in our homes, our schools, in our streets, and I do believe for as long as 80% of the kids in our BPS system receive free lunch, and 1 in 10 seniors live below the poverty line, and a fourth of the families in Dorchester, which I call my home neighborhood, are living on food stamps, that poverty is an agenda that is germane to municipal government, and there are deliberate, incremental, intentional steps that we can take to chip away at those big issues.
Thank you.
Hey everybody, I'm Sean Ryan. I'm the only candidate, as far as I know, that was born and raised in Jamaica Plain. I started attending public schools at the age of 4. I was put on a bus over to Roxbury, and then I went to school in Jamaica Plain as well, and then I was again bused over to Dorchester to go to the King School before I went to Latin School, where I majored in, where I studied music. I majored in music in college, so I haven't been, you know, devoted to politics for my entire life. And my goal in running is to elevate the discussion about what's taking place in the schools, and specifically to be a voice for the parents, because I've door-knocked all around the city. Parents have a significant amount of consensus already about what they want to see in the schools. You'll notice that there's lots of consensus among the candidates too, but I'm trying to be the voice for neighborhood schools in the city. And that includes right down here in the Back Bay Beacon Hill area. Everybody who wants a neighborhood school should be allowed that option, and people who have other preferences should be given those preferences as well. But until we listen to middle class and working class parents and give them what they want out of a school system, they're going to continue to leave, and we're not going to be able to solve some of these problems permanently. Thanks very much.
Thank you. And now if we go down to Felix.
All right. Good evening. My name is Felix Arroyo. I'm one of your 4 at-large city councilors. I am born and raised in the city of Boston, but I'm born and raised to parents who moved to Boston who are looking for a better life for themselves and for their families, chasing that American dream. I went into the Boston Public Schools without being able to speak a lick of English, which is all too common a story, frankly, for the students in our Boston Public Schools. It is that vision of the American dream that my parents shared with me as a young child that moved me to run for politics and to run for office, and that is the idea that you can feed your family, house your family, and clothe your family by working hard and following the rules, and maybe even spend some time with your family, not need 3 jobs to do it. That's what moves me. It's also as a youth sports coach, I watch young people now in the city, and I see that they don't have the same opportunities that I had growing up. And so I'm committed to the young people in this issue, but I'm committed to every family in the city, especially those of the least among us, to make sure that they have the same opportunities to succeed that my parents found here in the city of Boston, that I found here in the city of Boston. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm John Connolly, privileged to serve as one of your 4 at-large councilors. I will speed talk to answer this question. I hope you'll consider me for one of your 4 votes. In the past 2 years, I've focused every day as a former teacher, having taught children from every neighborhood in this city. I think about our schools every day, help get the expired food out of our schools, make sure our kids are getting fresher and healthier meals, and save tens of thousands of dollars in the process. Have led the effort on the council with Councilor Tito Jackson to raise our dropout age from 16 to 18. I helped increase our funding for English language learners, who will soon be over 50% of the students in Boston Public Schools. But the question went to what would we do if we serve in this next term. I will focus first on revamping vocational education so we're preparing our young people for jobs in green tech, clean tech, life sciences, biotech, and the healthcare field. I will reform our school assignment in a way that works for every neighborhood and every child. I'd like to bolster efforts around the achievement gap, and I haven't done enough work around addiction and recovery, and that's a major issue here, particularly when we look at what's going on with violence and how it impacts young people in our city. Thank you.
Good evening, my name is William Dorcena. I thank you so much for hosting this tonight. Born and raised in Dorchester, son of Haitian immigrants. Went to BC High, Boston College, and got my MBA at Babson. I'm running for Boston City Council for one main reason, and that's to shine a light in the darkness. And what I mean by that is too many decisions get made behind closed doors, outside of the scrutiny of the public and the media. You have the casino legislation as an example. You have over $1 billion being spent in the Boston Public Schools, and most of these kids aren't even given textbooks, which means they can't compete to get into these great colleges and universities 15 minutes from their home. And my big push in the city council is to put the checkbook online. Where is the money? $2.4 billion of our taxpayer dollars are being spent, and we have no idea where that money is being spent outside of what we're told. I think if we can take the information, put it in the hands of the public, I trust that we can make much better decisions and you can hold us accountable.
Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. My name is Michael Flaherty, and I'm running because I love this city and I want to make it work for everyone. I know so many people and have met so many people in the course of this campaign that feel that Boston doesn't work for them. Things that I'd like to do to help it make work for them is to remove the pay-to-play development process that we have in the city of Boston. Make it be more about the merits of your project and gaining community support than it is about who sign you hold, who you contribute, or who you hire. I'd like to take the $83 million we currently spend on fuel, maintenance, and repair, put it right back into the classroom for extended school day, before and after school programs, SAT prep, art, music. And finally, I'd like to have a citywide plan and a neighborhood-specific plan for crime and violence that also includes treatment on demand. The root of most crime is substance abuse. We need to have a system where people can get recovery when they want it, when they need it, not come back tomorrow, come back next week, no bed, no insurance. Let's get our communities healthy.
Thank you, Michael. And I want to thank all seven for keeping within the time frame. But to you, the audience, this is your introduction to the Magnificent Seven. And I thank you all. You all tended to bring in education, which when we talk about Boston, we cannot but talk about education. So I'd like to jump down to my question on education. The residents of the Back Bay, the West End, and Beacon Hill have been strongly advocating the creation of one or more public elementary schools in their neighborhoods. As part of this advocacy, there's been a call to reestablish, quote, neighborhood schools, unquote, where neighborhood children would have first priority in attending these schools, and which would likely lead to significant curtailment of the need to bus the school children. As part of this new proposal, 75% of the classroom seats available through the Boston Public School Lottery would be allocated to only those children within any school's walk zone instead of the current allocated level of only 50%. Would you support this proposal? And if not, why not? And Ayanna, would you start this one?
I'm sorry, did you say Ayanna?
You're up, Ayanna, yeah, please.
Oh, okay. All right. I mean, I believe the premise behind why there are not neighborhood schools here is because the presumption was that people living in downtown would not send their children to downtown schools. Certainly that's been challenged given the number of families that are sending their children to the Warren Prescott, the Elliott, and the Hurley. So I certainly can appreciate the intention behind wanting a school that is in walking distance. And every family should have that opportunity. But first, we have to create a legitimate culture of opportunity and equity across our school system in order that every family would believe that there would be a good faith effort made for their child to receive a quality education. For as long as there are social disparities and inequities that are playing out in our school system, creating a two-tiered system, I don't know that we can ever get to that place.
Could I ask you the direct question, would you support 75 versus 50%?
What, I'm sorry, one more time.
The 75, rather than have this 50% in lottery and 50% neighborhood, in busing, could we bring that to 75% neighborhood and 25% busing?
My answer still remains the same. It's just, you know, this is a difficult question to answer, and these forums become very frustrating because it becomes one of sort of a soundbite of political rhetoric in a very short minute when this is a complicated problem,
indeed,
one that we've been dealing with for 30 years. So again, until there is an equity in the education provided, I don't believe we'll be able to achieve consensus across the city to have neighborhood schools. But that being said, I do believe that is the ultimate goal. If there were visioning for what is the best thing for our families and this city, certainly it is to get to a place of neighborhood schools. But we're a long ways away from that for as long as we have an achievement gap and these inequities and disparities.
Thank you very much. Sean?
Well, as I mentioned before, I'm hoping to be the neighborhood schools candidate, so I do support a neighborhood school option for every child in this city, as well as other options, citywide options, for people with other preferences. So I would support the 75%, and I think I've made it clear that I would support complete neighborhood schools. Now, a neighborhood school is not going to work for everybody. There are going to be some people with special needs, and we have to cater to people's special needs. But if we don't start catering to the people who want a neighborhood school, there's just going to be fewer and fewer kids in the school system each year. The flight of the middle and working classes is continuing. We're having to close schools. When a school gets closed, then we have to figure out what to do with the building. You know, other folks may be shifted over into that building. We've had this controversy regarding BLA in Hyde Park, which was resolved today. So we need stability in the system. And the way I see it, and neighborhood schools is not a perfect system, but it will provide stability. Having the working class and the middle class involved in our school system again will make the education experience better for everybody. I can just give you a couple examples at the Trotter School from when I was a kid. Next time, thanks.
Thank you. Thank you for responding to the specific question. Felix.
It would be fairly difficult to go to a neighborhood school when you don't have a school in your neighborhood. And I don't think we're at the moment now where we can move to a place where it would be 75%, because what happens to those neighborhoods that don't have schools, where do they fall on the list? I will agree with Councilor Pressley that the ultimate goal should be neighborhood schools. The ultimate goal should be to have a school in every neighborhood, and the ultimate goal should be to have a school that is so good that the people in that neighborhood actually want to go there. That should be the ultimate goal. And that's what we should be working towards. I think I answered your question directly, and I also gave an explanation to it. I'll also say that I've been thinking a lot about the neighborhood I'm in and the fact that you don't have an elementary school nearby. Within 15 seconds, one of the thoughts that have come to my mind, and I proposed in sort of in conversation with others, was what's going to happen to 26 Court Street when the school department moves out? What's going to happen to that building? Can that building be retrofitted to be an elementary school? We already have a building. It even has an auditorium space in it. So the idea is looking at what's available to us now and to see what, how can we fix the problem we have in these neighborhoods.
Thank you.
So I joined with State Representative Marty Walls and Representative Aaron Mikowitz and District Councilor Mike Ross in a meeting earlier this year about bringing a school to the downtown area in addition to expanding the Elliott School in the North End. And I would say for the first time, and I have not been involved in these efforts as long as Representative Walls and Councilor Ross have, but for the first time, we felt there was significant progress being made in terms of identifying facilities and presenting real funding plans. Still have a long way to go, but it was an encouraging meeting. To the question, yeah, I'd support 75%, but we ought to acknowledge this. It won't work. When you actually look at the numbers between the sibling preference and the fact that some people have four schools in a walk zone, and some people only have one, and some people have none, it won't work. If you want to solve a student assignment, you need a much more intricate solution. And the only way this policy will be reformed is if you build a consensus across all neighborhoods. You need Roxbury and West Roxbury on board. I would say I don't buy the piece about having to wait a long time to get there. You just need to build the consensus.
Mr. Dorcena?
As of today, no, I would not support that. The way you solve the problem in Roxbury and West Roxbury is to have good schools in West Roxbury and in Roxbury. The reason why a father or mother wakes up at 5 o'clock in the morning and puts their kid on a bus with no seatbelts is because they do not want their child to go to that school down the street in Roxbury or in Dorchester, because unfortunately, most of the underperforming schools are located in Roxbury, Dorchester, and Mattapan. And so today, for me to say I would support 75% means supporting, continuing for families in these neighborhoods to send their kids to schools that they know isn't going to be the best for their kids' future. So as of today, no. I think if we can get a new superintendent, we can move to an elected school committee, and hopefully get a new mayor in this city, we could actually invest in the Boston Public Schools versus closing the Boston Public Schools. During Race to the Top, 14 out of the 18 schools that were defined as underperforming were located in Dorchester, Roxbury, and Mattapan. So no, as of today.
Thank you. Mr. Clark?
Thank you, Peter. This city squandered an opportunity to put a school in this neighborhood. When I was president of the council, working with my colleague, Councilor Michael Ross, and Councilor Murphy, to my left, identified a site, and the whole thing was in play, but we had a stubborn administration that didn't want to move and was convinced that this community in the downtown area didn't need a school. So keep in perspective, we're educating 6,000 less kids today than we were 10 years ago. And also mention that, as referenced, $83 million gets spent on fuel, maintenance, and repair. If we don't move, and we don't have a stepping off point and right now it's 50-50, then we're going to continue to have the same discussion 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 20 years from now. I think that's fair to at least start to move in that direction, recognizing that we don't have enough quality schools. We are losing families. And at the same token, as Councilor Arroyo had mentioned, that there are some neighborhoods that don't have schools that would actually need to build schools. But I think we need a stepping off point. I think 75-25 would be a fair and appropriate start. Let's move off 50-50 because 50-50 is not working and we're losing families.
Thank you. Mr. Murphy?
Yeah, I think 75-25 would be much more adequate and reasonable than what we have today. One of the major weaknesses of our student assignment plan is the fact that because we're busing kids all over the city, we have a lack of parental involvement because kids are so disengaged geographically from their home area. We have community policing, we have community centers, we have community libraries, but we don't have school and community tied as well. As Councilor Flaherty, former Councilor Flaherty said, we spent $88 million on transportation right now, and we should be building new schools. We have a favorable reimbursement rate from the Mass School Building Authority where we would be putting up less than 20%. So if we wanted to build an $80 million brand new facility, the city's cost would be about $16 million. That's about one-fifth, a little less than one-fifth of what we're spending blowing smoke up a tailpipe. So I would support the 75%. Thank you.
Thank you all. The next question starts with Sean Ryan. What do you consider to be the greatest problems facing Boston's neighborhoods? And what do you believe has been the single biggest social change Boston has seen over the past decade? What challenges have these problems and this social change presented to the residents of the city, and what would you do to address them? And all that in 1 minute.
Sure. Well, the two biggest problems are schools and safety. Those just happen to be my first and third S on my 3S platform, which is schools, services, and safety. These problems are much more difficult now than they even were over the past decade because of the collapse in the real estate boom. So anytime you have an artificial boom, and it's specifically very connected to how we fund local government, because the majority of the funds that the city spends come from property taxes. So if they tell you that your home is going up 20% every year, it means that the city had more revenue, and we don't have it now. My services tagline is doing more with less. What makes me different is I'm a bit more conservative than the other candidates in that I'm acknowledging the fact that we have less money as a city and less money as a society, and I would prefer that we make an orderly transition from spending money on failed policies and policies that are continuing and have failed to achieve their stated ends, and then start spending money on things that people do want. People don't want to see libraries closed. People don't want to see community centers closed. But we all have to have an adult conversation about where this money is going to come from, because we simply don't have what we used to have. Thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Arroyo?
For me, my focus is and continues to be the young people of this city. I chair the Committee on Youth Affairs, and I think that opportunities for our young people should be our first priority. It's for that reason that working with my colleagues on the City Council, I led the effort to restore youth summer jobs and fully fund year-round jobs out of the City of Boston for young people. It's why working with my colleagues on the Council, I led the effort to make sure that we didn't lose a single branch library in this city. I'm going to use 30 seconds for that, 30 seconds for social change. I think the biggest social change is frankly, acceptance. The fact that we have gay marriage in our state and in our city makes me very proud. And to think 10 years ago, what it was like for members of the LGBT community, and to look today at the acceptance of that community, I think is something we should all be proud of. The next one is frankly electoral, and it's the fact that residents of Boston have shown that they no longer see race as an impediment to being elected. And I'll go through the numbers. In 2002, my father became the first Latino to ever serve on a city council. In 2005, Sam Yoon became the first Asian American to serve on a city council. Stop. 2004, Andrew Cabal was elected, and the list goes on and on.
Thank you. We'll give you the opportunity to get that list out.
It's a list we should be proud of.
Indeed. John Connell.
I'll start with saying I know when we're in the downtown area that development is a major issue, and that you want to know that you have voices there at City Hall who are going to make sure that we're preserving the integrity and quality of our neighborhoods when it comes to development. And I hope that you have found that I have been responsive to that when you've needed. However, when we talk about the major issues facing the city, I have to put two ahead of that and start with youth violence. As long as there are any young people dying on our streets, it is not okay, and it is the most important issue facing the city. And second, dovetails into it, in my mind, the best public safety policy are great schools. That's why I'm trying to lead the effort to raise our dropout age from 16 to 18. That 16-year-old is the dropout is the person most likely to be arrested and incarcerated in Boston. As for social change, again, I come at it as a former teacher and schools person, English language learners. That's a great thing. Our city has so many young people speaking so many different languages, but we are fast approaching a day where more than 50% of the students in Boston Public Schools will be English language learners. We need to make sure we're doing everything we can for them. Thank you.
Thank you. Dorcena.
I think the biggest challenge facing the neighborhoods of Boston is crime and violence. I went to a funeral just this past Monday to a young 22-year-old kid who is a Boston College student, was pumping gas in Mattapan Square and got shot 3 times, and now he's dead. There are way too many kids I grew up with who are either dead or in prison and cannot contribute positively to life here in Boston. I think we have to solve the crime and violence issue by working more closely with the Boston police and with the families. The biggest social change, I think, is gay marriage. And how I think we address that is make sure we have education throughout the Boston Public School system to educate the parents, to educate the students, and to train the teachers so that we don't have bullying. Right now, bullying is a big issue throughout much of the Boston Public School system with the kids, and we need to do that education effectively.
Thank you. Biggest challenge facing the city is crime and violence. We do a great job reacting to crime. We don't do a good enough job preventing crime from happening. We need a citywide plan and a neighborhood-specific plan. Whether crime takes place in this community or your respective communities or any neighborhood in the city, it pains us all to see the headlines, to read the newspaper, to watch the nightly news when you see someone has been lost to senseless violence. And it does that because we're all Bostonians. We all care about each other, and we want to make sure that our city's doing the best it can to prevent this. It obviously needs an all-encompassing approach of increasing employment opportunities, substance abuse treatment and recovery, and making sure that we're getting the guns off the street. And the biggest social change I will concur with what has already been stated is the acceptance of LGBT. Proud to be the very first citywide elected official in Boston to publicly support marriage equality, and hope to continue to see that community add great value to our city.
Mr. Murphy.
The biggest social change actually was just clearly evident in the new census numbers that came out. There's been new growth in the city of population, but it's been downtown. It's been in areas like this. It's been in the northern part of the city. And our biggest challenge with regard to that is to shift city services in this direction to make sure that, you know, we need new growth. We've had cutbacks in local aid and federal government cutbacks to operate our city on, so we rely on new growth, but it must be done responsibly. We can't plow under the standard of living for people in the downtown neighborhoods as we try to deal with new growth. That's infrastructure. That's new schools, parks, playgrounds, etc. And that's the real challenge moving forward from those census numbers, how to balance those concerns and make sure we don't impact in a negative way the quality of life of the people who've moved in down here because they know it has a lot to offer.
Thank you. Ms. Pressley.
I would say the biggest challenge facing the city is violence, but not just street violence. Violence in our homes, we're seeing a rise in intimate partner violence. Violence in our schools, it's already been referenced that we're seeing a rise in bullying, as well as petty crime and violence in our streets. But it's not just a moral imperative that we have as a city to make sure that people feel safe. There is an economic impact. If you look at the Circle of Promise, there are 150 nonprofits in the Circle of Promise. We need more development. And you're not going to have commercial development, which is going to mean you're going to have lost opportunity for jobs and revenue and tax base. Businesses are not incentivized to go into communities that are unsafe. So we have a moral imperative to make sure the city is safe for everyone, but there's also an economic impact if we do not do that. The biggest social change would be shifting population and demographics. We're a more diverse city, and we've made some strides in being a more welcoming and inclusive city, but there's still much work to be done around that, which is why I'm working on the issue of public accommodation to make sure our venues of public accommodation are accommodating to everyone.
Thank you. I would like to pause here for a moment, first of all, to give the seven a chance to catch their breath. But I would like to point out to the audience, these are very detailed questions, very heavy, with many of the sub-questions tucked into them. And I think that the seven have been very responsive to the question and understanding that we want them to go deeper into the issues that they're wrestling with. Thank you all. Paused enough?
This one is very specific. There are two state laws that limit the amount of new shadows that may be cast on the Boston Common public garden. These laws have allowed new development near the parks while ensuring that the parks and those who use them have as much sunlight as possible. A new bill has been recently proposed that would extend these laws to several more parks, including Copley Square, Commonwealth Avenue Mall, the Back Bay Fens, Christopher Columbus Park, and the North End. What is your position on this proposed legislation? If you support it, will you advocate for its passage? If you oppose it, why do you oppose it? Also, what other measures would you support to protect these and other urban parks and the public green spaces to ensure that they are properly maintained? And I believe this starts with you, Felix Arroyo.
All right. I appreciate the break because I am an asthmatic and going through these things.
Yeah, but I'm dyslexic and reading this.
But no one's keeping time on you, Peter. The answer is yes, I support it. It's an issue I know fairly well, but not as well as its author who is sitting in the room today, and that's Representative Marty Walls. The reason I know the issue is because Marty Walls has been on my phone about every other day from when she filed it, making sure that I understood enough to say that yes, I do support it. And why do I support it? I believe that cities, that the development can be a very good thing in a city. It's frankly a must, or else the city becomes stagnant and stale. But one of the issues that I find is that sometimes people develop, and you're going to say most times people develop, without realizing that people actually live in the neighborhood they're developing in. People, downtown areas are not just for shopping. There are also people who live here, and those people need to be respected, and those people's opinions should be heard. And I stand fully with communities, whether it's downtown or in the parkway, that they be heard in development issues. Thank you.
Mr. Kahn?
So I read one of the two. I'm not sure I've read both, but it was at Representative Wall's urging. I'll say again,
I'll just pause for a second and tell you, it's nice that all of you have been urged. So have I.
Am I out of time? So I've read one of the two. I haven't read both, and I'll say this: I'm open to it, but I am concerned, and I'm not going to tell you what you want to hear. I'm not a blanket yes on it. My concern would be that it would hamper appropriate development in some cases, and I don't want to do that, especially not in this economy. By the same token, I don't want to rubber stamp bad projects either.
I'll give you a few more seconds.
Yeah, I don't want to rubber stamp bad projects either, and I think that's why you hope that and what we try to do in the development process is advocate strongly for what respects the quality and integrity of a neighborhood, but also balance the need for neighborhoods to have new life breathed into it and the appropriateness for economic development across our entire city. I think we need a balance, and my concern on the law, though I'm open to it, is that it will shift the balance too far one way.
Thank you, Mr. Dorcena. I do support the law. And the reason why is because this is Boston. This isn't Chicago. This isn't New York. This is the city of Boston. You know, my wife is from Connecticut, and I remind her every day that this is the best city on the face of the earth. And I think we actually feel that way because we have a two-year-old daughter, and we spend a lot of time in the public gardens and a lot of time in Copley Square and on the Rose Kennedy Greenway. And it just feels so great to be able to just walk the city without having to be in a Chicago or in a New York. And I've been to those cities. You know, I like those cities too, but it's not the city of Boston. I think we have to have some control over the development. Overdevelopment is just not good. So I would support it. And I would work with the representative to make sure that you get all the support that you need. What I think we can do also is to make sure we have recycling in all of our parks. We do have trash bins everywhere you go, but we need more recycling. You know, if you're drinking a bottled water, don't throw it in the trash. It'd be nice to have a recycling container right there where you can put it in.
Thank you. Mr. Flaherty.
Thank you, Peter. Representative Marty Walls has proposed this because of the way development works in the city of Boston. And if development in the city of Boston worked like all other major cities, we wouldn't probably need legislation like this. I shared with her some of my concerns about the reluctance to sort of relinquish city control, but under the current leadership, it has to happen. Not only do we have a pay-to-play system where people are allowed to build to whatever height that they want, given, again, who they hire and who they're plugged into. Open space in our city is a jewel and should be respected. So I would love to have a little flexibility in it to be able to let the city adjust to some forces, whether it's green tech or high tech and, you know, things that might come down the pike. But the overall approach that I've had with Representative Walls is that I do support it. And again, it's necessary because of what's happening in our city.
Thank you. Mr. Murphy.
I've actually read the bill, and congratulations to Representative Walls and Representative Rushing, who co-sponsored it. What it basically does is allow development to continue within zoning limits around the Public Garden and the Boston Common, and it would expand those protections to other parks. And all it's saying is live within zoning. What's wrong with that? Why can't we have that? Why can't we have it both ways? There's been tremendous new growth around the Boston Common and the Public Garden over the last 10 years. And also with that law in place. And I don't see any reason why we can't move that into other areas so we don't destroy the sunlit part of our parks and playgrounds. And just on point of parks and my advocacy for them, I and Councilor Mike Ross banded together twice to save the park rangers. So that's a very, very important piece that I want to get out there. So yes, I do support Representative Walls' state law. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. President.
Council President Murphy, you make a compelling argument. Rep. Walls, I must concede my feelings are a little hurt. I have not been lobbied. And I won't personalize. But in truthfully, Rep. Walls is a strong progressive voice. I appreciate the intent behind the legislation in light of the fact that all too often the community voice is not respected and that input integrated in a meaningful way. It's often happening on the back end of a process. And more as an exercise rather than a meaningful exchange of community input. I lived in the Back Bay for 5 years. I do not own a car. The lure of this area is that it is walkable and the development is dense, and I certainly don't want to walk in any shadows. That being said, I'm open to it. I do have some concerns. Mainly because we would be shifting all of that to the state, and they already control liquor licenses, which is also adversely impacting our ability to develop.
Thank you. Sean Ryan.
I'd like to echo what Mike and what Ayanna said. We have a very politically controlled development process in this town. We already have tons and tons of rules, so pretty much any development always needs a variance. So there's always a point at which you have to ask a politician, or it depends more on who you know or what lawyer you've hired. And that being said, I don't think that we should be putting our development standards up to the state level, because it's much harder to change things if you make a mistake at the state level than it is at the city or the local level. I would prefer that we completely scrap some of the archaic zoning rules we have and have a community process so that we can get rules that everybody agrees on, and so that, you know, you don't need a variance. It's not always politically controlled. Developers know what they're dealing with in advance, and then, you know, and we don't put them through a process that takes years and years and years. And that results in examples like the hole in the ground in Downtown Crossing, where people have budgeted a certain amount of time and money. You know, then you have a bust in the housing boom, and we're left with a hole instead of a place of doing business in our downtown.
Thank you. And the next question will start with John Connolly. Where does the current state of the city fiscal health stand, and where can the city find sustainable new sources of revenue, and what cuts would you recommend be made if cuts are necessary?
So I think the fiscal health of the city overall is strong. And I'll say that it's for a few different reasons. One, we maintain healthy reserves, unlike many cities, and due in large part to what the city council has done. We're always focused on healthy reserves. Second, we don't borrow to an excessive point, and because of our high bond rating, we can borrow at a lower rate. So that's created strong fiscal health. Two concerns: OPEB or other post-employment benefits and unfunded pension liabilities. They're both unfunded pension liabilities, and the day is coming due soon. I've advocated strongly to put money in those reserve funds to pay those down. If we don't do that, we are mortgaging our future. As far as 15 seconds. As far as raising revenue, I'm a strong supporter of Councilor Murphy's work around the pilot initiative and making sure that our large tax-exempt institutions are paying their fair share and giving back to our neighborhoods. I think that's the number one place we ought to go. Done. Okay.
Thank you very much. Thank you for abiding by that.
I think in terms. Thank you. I think in terms of where we are in terms of the fiscal health of the city, I do think the fiscal health of the city is strong, but I do think there's a lot that we do not know. For example, the Boston Public Schools spends over $1 billion a year. $800 million of that is out of the general fund. Over $200 million is never really broken down, and I've gone to all the budget meetings, and we can't get a breakdown, a complete breakdown of that $200 million. So I think we do need a very detailed accounting in terms of where the $2.4 billion is being spent, which is why I'm advocating for the city to put the checkbook online. I do support the pilot program, just not the way we're going about it now. I think we need to, when elected officials are running for office, we find every single nonprofit organization and civic association to go in front of you and present ourselves. We need to take the pilot conversation into the neighborhoods so that we can get the residents of the city to support having these institutions pay more. I'm a proud graduate alum of Boston College, but that's an example of an institution that needs to pay more.
Thank you.
In every municipal government, there is wasteful spending, and Boston is no different. I've continued to promote CityStat, which is an effective management tool that will help drive the cost of delivery of basic city services down. Delivery of services gets increased, but the cost associated go down. Things like 311 to relieve our overburdened 911 system, which would save money. Snow melters as part of our snow removal arsenal would go a long way. Also, when I was president of the council, created the first committee on pilot reform, special committee, and appointed Councilor Murphy as chair to rein in the colleges and universities that had continued to gobble up property off of the tax roll, sticking us residents with a bigger tax bill. And interestingly enough, the BRA played a role in closing their eyes to Harvard land banking using straw buyers. And now they have a massive hole in the ground and false promises and rats running around over there like it's no one's business. And again, that's because of the way the development was. So pilot reform was a big part when I was on the council, and will continue to be a staunch advocate to rein in those college and universities and hospitals.
Thank you. Mr. Murphy.
The current state of the city's finances is really excellent. It's a AA-plus bond rating. It's the highest it's ever been. And the administration, the Menino administration, along with the council, can take great pride in managing our resources effectively. And as Councilor Connolly alluded to, we don't bond to our debt limit. We bond below it. We actually could go a little bit higher with capital projects and not impact adversely our bond rating. And that's something I think we should do. When places like the hole in the ground that was Filene's get stalled, we got to look at going in there and getting something going with city funds and city bondability to maybe put some people back to work. I think that, you know, the pilot stuff that we've done, all in open, all transparent, all in the city council chamber, and then a special committee, increasing revenue by $30 million from our not-for-profits that can afford to pay it. And we've got a lot to be proud of as a city in terms of our financial management.
Thank you. Ms. Pressley.
Yes, I agree. Compared to other municipalities, our fiscal health is sound. I didn't have the opportunity to vote in support. I wasn't on the council then for the meals and hotels tax, but I would have because much of our new revenue is coming from our tourism dollars, and we can see that proportional. I think that's one of the best new ways, given that that's a new and emerging industry, that we can continue to generate new revenue. I commend Council President Murphy for his leadership when it comes to pilot reform, but I also agree that we have to look at, when you have a bad economy, there's really no such thing as a good budget, and so you're doing the best that you can, and we've done that, but we have to look to weed out inefficiencies, which is why I have called an order for a hearing to look at how we can be more efficient in our snow removal, and it's also why I will continue to advocate for the creative economy. I'm pushing for the designation of cultural districts in all of our neighborhoods, who will agree that arts and culture will be their main economic driver.
Thank you. Mr. Ryan.
I think our city finances look pretty well, but I'm trying to be entrepreneurial and forward-looking, and we are in an era of absolute lowest interest rates we've ever seen. They're only going to go up, and what that's going to mean is it's not just going to hit the city, it's going to hit some of our industries as well, specifically the higher education industry. When people aren't able to get a 0% loan,
you know, for a degree that's not going to get them a job, and this is going to pop, the debt bubble is going to pop in higher education, you know, that industry is going to be facing some challenges. So we don't need to make it any harder for them. I don't support raising taxes. I don't support raising fees. I don't support raising pilot. As I've mentioned before, I think we have to be doing more with less, and there's plenty ways that we can find savings in our current city budget, specifically in the school system. We do spend over $1 billion, and we spend per capita about 15 grand per kid. We're not getting the great results, and that's because a lot of that money spending is being spent on transportation, on the bureaucracy downtown. It's not making its way to the classroom. So we have to learn to be more thrifty. I'm just trying to be honest about what we're going to face over the next few years. Thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Arroyo.
I agree with Councilor Connolly about our commitment to our fund of pension liability. I agree with Councilor Murphy's work and supported his work around pilot reform and looking for these largest nonprofit institutions to pay their fair share. Just to be clear, we're looking at half, if not a little more than half, of the property in the city of Boston is not taxed, and that's why that conversation is coming up. So half of the city is half of us are paying the load. For the other half, that also includes state property, where there are small businesses in the state property not paying taxes to the city. That makes no sense. My last 15 seconds, is we have to know how to leverage our capital to help the economy in the city we're in. I filed an order called the Invest in Boston Order, where we would take our $1 billion we have invested in banks today and make sure it's invested in banks that are investing in our community. My time is up. I see you doing it.
Well, I'm going to have the opportunity to ask the bullet question, and you know it's coming, and I'm looking for a yes or no answer. The question is, would you support having a gambling venue such as a casino or a slots parlor in the greater Boston area as a way to bring revenue into the city? Could I start with Felix? We'll just go right down the line. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes.
The whole question is premised on a referendum question that should take place in the city of Boston. Right. I would defer to the will of the people.
Okay.
No.
Yes.
Yes.
No.
I don't think that the government should be able to do things that we can't. So if the government wants to run a lottery, the people should be able to do it too. Okay.
Thank you. Let me go to the next question that I would ask is, pardon me? Okay. The next question starts with Will. The question is, the continued, and we've been toying with this, so here's a chance to really play. The continued institutional expansion in Boston is viewed by many of our downtown residents as threatening the character of our neighborhoods. What concerns do you have about such expansion activities, and what specific ideas do you have to counter such activities?
That's a good question. I think the biggest concern that I have with the academic institutions is how many local kids, this is specific to colleges and universities, is how they are not opening their doors in a really open way to local kids from the city of Boston. That's my biggest problem. When I was at Boston College, from 1991 until 2011, I've been in a 20-year fight, a good fight, with BC to accept more kids from the city of Boston. You know, that institution, again, I'll speak about BC because it's my alma mater. That institution was founded in 1863 for poor immigrant kids in the city who at the time happened to be Irish. And today, we do not have a lot of kids from the city of Boston who are attending BC. So my big concern with these academic institutions is they continue to expand and they're not making room for those of us who are locals, those of us who are born and raised here and live in the city every single day. And I think how we can combat some of that is to hold their feet to the fire. And I think the pilot program, if done more effectively, is a great way to do that. We need to take the pilot conversation into the people's living rooms and in their backyards. That's how we're going to get the full support.
Can we stop there for a moment, because some might not know what the pilot program is. Okay. So are you comfortable, could I turn to you and ask you just to give a brief description of the program?
Yes, definitely.
Please.
I think I'll make BC proud right now. Let me see. The pilot program stands for Payment in Lieu of Taxes. Nonprofit organizations that own land in the city of Boston are tax exempt. And right now, the pilot program, as it stands, those that have property valued at $15 million or more are supposed to pay some amount of money to the city of Boston, but it's all voluntary. it's not mandatory, it's all voluntary. So that's
thank
what the pilot
much. I appreciate that. And I think that will help the audience, some of the audience, to understand the responses.
Please. Thank you, Peter. Our colleges and universities and our hospitals are some of our city's greatest assets. They're also some of our city's largest employers. And so I want to recognize that, largely given by the fact that a lot of folks from the communities of Boston either attend or work there. They do the city a huge disservice when they continue to gobble up property off the tax roll, shifting the tax burden to regular residents such as ourselves. They need to be better neighbors, respecting the quality of life for all of our communities, Back Bay, Beacon Hill, Mission Hill, Alston, Brighton, etc., all the way through where we're seeing the expansion. We need to put pressure on them to keep the students on their campus and to make the room and board attractive so that the students will want to stay on campus as opposed to out in the community where they can bunk with three or four of their colleagues. It wasn't too long ago that I was over at Boston College and Boston University School of Law, so I know firsthand how students react. They're on a budget too, and if they could save money by living off campus for pizza and beer, they'll do that.
Thank you. Mr. Murphy.
Cities don't get income tax. Only up until last year did we get a very small portion of meals tax. We rely on property taxes. When I first got into the council, 51% of the land and buildings were tax exempt. Last year, 54% of the land and buildings are tax exempt. All this while the federal and state government pulls back because they have their own financial issues on local aid. So if we don't do something with regard to payments in lieu of taxes, we hit a wall pretty soon, and we can't offer services of police, fire, education, etc. And that's why I went forward with the mayor to begin to reform payment in lieu of taxes, to actually put a formula down there, to actually go out and get a value for every one of these land and buildings of all these large not-for-profits. So now we're trying to contain them from expanding because when they increase their footprint, they got to pay. When Northeastern University was only paying $19,000 in a payment in lieu of taxes in 2009, that's sinful. So we've made a change.
Thank you. Ms. Pressley.
What else can I say? I agree. They've got to do a better job at housing their own populations. If they can't build out, then, you know, well, in any event, it's adversely impacting quality of life. It's an adversarial relationship. They've got to be more respectful of abutters and be better partners. I don't want to demonize our colleges and universities. They do make this a destination location and an attractive city for people from throughout the world to come here to receive the best educations. But they're just being greedy and not exercising a greater responsibility and respecting the quality of life needs of residents.
Thank you. Mr. Ryan.
Well, I don't think these institutions are greedy. I think that they've responded to incentives that have been created over the past decade, like ultra-low interest rates and all this money that's been fed into the healthcare sector and into the higher education sector. So that's why we've seen so much institutional expansion, you know, by Northeastern and Harvard. It's because they've had the money to do so. When it becomes apparent that most of these students, not most, but a very large number of students are not going to be able to pay off their college debts because they can't get jobs, you know, these institutions are going to get hit hard, and they probably won't be expanding anymore because their class base is going to go down. And I think that many of them have overexpanded, but it wasn't just because they were greedy. They're just operating, you know, a higher learning institution. They're responding to the incentives that told them that there's plenty of money to go around, there's plenty of people, there's a huge demand for college, and that's why they've expanded. So I think we're going to naturally see some of these factors start to dissipate over the next few years because of the bubble popping in student loan debt.
Thank you. Mr. Arroyo.
The question, as I remember, was about institutional expansion. And yes, it's an issue here. You have Suffolk University around the corner. It's an issue in Mission Hill, Roxbury. You have Northeastern right there. It's an issue in Alston, Brighton. You have Boston University. You have BC. It's an issue in the Fenway area. You have a slew of the smaller colleges, Emmanuel, Wheelock, Simmons, all there. It's an issue that we have to deal with in our city. Yes, I am proud of the fact that we have the best higher education institutions in the world right here in Boston. And yes, I understand that they employ many Boston residents. But no, I don't think that they should take precedent over people who live in a neighborhood when it comes to development plans. An example of a complete atrocity is what's happening right now in Alston Brighton. I recognize it's not in this neighborhood, but if you're worried about the hole in filing the basement, go to Alston Brighton and see the hole that Harvard left right there. It was promised that they would do the work. We're talking about a We know what their endowment is at Harvard University. We're not silly people in this room. If they wanted to develop that project the way they promised the community they would. They just decided to stop. And that needs to end, and we need to take these decisions very serious, and it happens stop. At the community level. Thank you.
Thank you.
Peter, with all due respect, I'm not trying to be terrible here. It was an institutional expansion question, right? Not a pilot question.
Yes.
Okay. On institutional expansion, I say this to all of you concerned with development. Know my record on this. Look at what I did in Alston Brighton. I was the only city councilor who went up and opposed the Charles View land swap with Harvard University, in which they were going to move affordable housing, put luxury condos on one side of the road and the poor people on the other side of the road. And I worked with neighbors, and I went up to the BRA board and I said, this is wrong. I drove a hard bargain on Boston College in my first year in office, harder than most of the elected officials who were working on it. Did the same thing with Harvard University on their other institutional expansion plan in my second year in office. That's what I mean when you see the quality and integrity, character in your neighborhood being threatened. We're here to help. We're here to advocate. We're here to work as hard as we can. I see that more often than not when it comes to institutional expansion, encroaching into neighborhoods and not talking to neighbors.
Thank you. Did we start with you, Will Dorcena?
Yes, you did.
Thank you. The next question is connected to this. The BRA has taken the lead role in development of large residential, particularly luxury developments, and other large institutional projects. Are you satisfied with the BRA's emphasis on these types of projects, or do you think that the BRA should play a different role?
My position is the time has come to have a standalone planning department in the city of Boston, just like other major cities and communities from around the Commonwealth and beyond have. And again, I've referenced it, if I've said it once, I've said it several times, the way that development happens in the city, it's less about the content and the merit of your proposal. It's less about whether or not the community supports it or is opposed to it. It's about who you hire, who's going to do the job, who's connected to who signed, who held who signed and who made whose contribution to who, and unacceptable today's day and age. And so what we need to have is a planning department that actually listens to the community. When I started running for public office, you'd go to a community meeting over a small issue, the place would be packed. You go to a hot button issue these days, no one goes. Why bother? The cake is baked. The decision's already made. So going through the exercise of putting the dinner on the back of the stove and taking time away from your family to go to a local community meeting to give your input. And if anyone here thinks that your input's taken seriously, it's not. Standalone planning department is the way we need to go.
Thank you.
I have a lot of issues with the BRA. The BRA was created by state law in the late 1950s to take development out of the hands of elected officials who, back many, many years ago, were using their own districts as personal fiefdoms. So they brought the BRA in to reform a system back then. Does the BRA need some reform? Absolutely. Look what's going on down in the West End with the bubble garage, with the equity process. They want to put 500 units in there. They'll absolutely destroy the character and integrity of that neighborhood with the size and the density of what they're offering there. And that needs to be stopped, and something needs to be stopped. The problem with trying to change the BRA is that in order to change a state law, we could offer a home rule petition through the council, and it needs the signature of the mayor to move forward. So it's never going to happen unless the mayor deems that the BRA should be abolished and something new should happen.
Thank you. Ms. Pressley.
I also support there being an independent planning arm. You know, we talked a lot about the hole in the downtown Boston, and only recently started talking about the hole in the middle of Dudley. I think, you know, many of those projects there are real estate development and not commercial development. Again, we need to see development not only in downtown but in our neighborhoods. But businesses will not be incentivized to go into those neighborhoods if they are unsafe. So I do see those issues as being connected. Also, it is critically important that we continue to fight for a meaningful community input process, a meaningful visioning process, a community input process that is integrated and fully respected. But again, I do believe that we need to have an independent planning arm, but there needs to be a commitment to development in downtown and in our neighborhoods. We've got to eliminate some of these inequities in development, which is why we also have to look at our licensing.
Thank you. Mr. Ryan.
Well, the BRA was created in the 1950s, you know, to redevelop downtown Boston. There was a time when we didn't have a BRA, and most of our most beautiful neighborhoods existed at that time and were built during that time. And I think if you ask most people, if you look at, you know, the crowning achievements of the BRA, i.e. the West End and Government Center, you know, there's something lacking, something, you know, could have been done better. The problem with having government-controlled development is that there's this big bureau, and regardless of what the conditions are on the ground, you know, they just keep doing the same stuff. Like, for example, there's not that much development going on downtown compared to a few years ago, and I haven't heard any layoffs, you know, at the BRA. So what's going on here? What are all these people doing with their time? So, I mean, that's the danger of having a bureaucracy running the show instead of somebody that's, you know, going to respond more acutely. And I also want to point out that it's not just the BRA. Some of the local zoning codes are terrible. It's impossible to get a curb cut, you know, for your driveway. It's impossible to do all sorts of things to your house, you know, without going down to City Hall. And it's taken my brother and I a year and a half, and there's someone down at City Hall who will remain nameless who just doesn't like the Ryan family, and we can't get her a curb cut.
Well, I'll walk down with you. We'll figure that out. Mr. Arroyo.
I'm sorry, I just had to laugh. yes to a planning department separate of the BRA. I think our economic development should be done in one department, our planning should be done in another. This idea of having them both in the same department is so good that no other municipality has copied it. I also come at this as somebody who, like many of you, who I see at the community meetings that I attend and my staff attends, what I am, consider myself a community activist. I was the vice chair of my neighborhood council. And I remember getting so frustrated, raise your hand if you've seen this, I would actually see BRA flyers about community meetings where either the date or the location was to be determined. They would pass that out at a meeting, and it would say to be determined. That is right there, plain as day, letting you know their interest in your ideas, and that's why we need a separate planning department.
Thank you.
Natural conflict of interest. You've got an economic development wing that wants to make money, and it's directly linked to the planning wing. That makes no sense. It's an inherent conflict of interest, and it needs to be created and structured in a way that it's a check and balance and not a money-making enterprise. I'm not satisfied with the BRA. I'm not satisfied with the zoning board, the licensing board, or the entertainment and licensing board. What we need in this city is complete transparency. That's what we want. Start with the basic pieces. Online access to decisions and timetables and schedules. Move to the next piece. We need bright line standards. It's all the gray in the zoning code and the building code that allows a single city official at some desk to just let something sit forever. Create real time frames, bright line standards, and complete access online, and then you're getting toward a real transparent government and creating a real culture of transparency that can make this city work for its residents, which is what should be going on.
Thank you. Mr. Dorsey.
I say yes, you separate the powers of the BRA. We do need a standalone planning committee. When I was the president of the Dudley Street Neighborhood Initiative, DSNI, we fought the BRA. And when they came to our offices, they found out pretty quickly that we were very effective at fighting. And it's because we were very well organized. And so I do think we need to rein in the BRA. The example with the West End garage that Councilor Murphy mentioned with the Amy Lowell house, it's a complete disgrace in how the people at the Amy Lowell house, their voices weren't heard. I think Councilor Murphy's right you need the mayor's support. How do you get the mayor's support? You pressure the mayor. How do you pressure the mayor? You go directly to the people who he cares most about, which are the voters. We have to take the conversation outside of these rooms, outside of the city council chamber, and bring it into the neighborhoods. We're very effective at doing that and finding you when it comes time for election. We need to find you and bring this conversation directly to you. And I think if the people are organized the way we were organized at DSNI, we would be very effective at fighting the BRA.
And lastly, Mr. Clark.
You started the question.
Oh, did I start with you? Forgive me. I'm going to do something now. Incidentally, I thought your response was terrific. I just wanted to hear it again. We're at the point where we're at the closing statements. And here, it's 2 minutes. Yeah, I know, it's going to be hard to absorb 2 minute time, but here we try. And let's start with Mr. Murphy.
Thank you, Peter. Good evening to everybody. It's been an honor to be here speaking with you and talking about all of our different ideas. It's also a great honor to be an elected city councilor-at-large and the president of the city council. We've had a very productive 2 years in this term. We have disagreed with the mayor on several occasions without being overly personal or disagreeable. I can cite a number of things we've done. Councilor Ross is in the back of the room. He was president last year. We took a very hot button issue, the firefighter contract. There are two big sides to that. Do we allow collective bargaining to continue as a right the way it is? Or do we send it back and blow up collective bargaining for public unions? Councilor Ross, and working, I was his vice president at the time, put it in the committee of the whole. We saved taxpayers $43 million and resolved a firefighter contract. It was a fine hour for the city council. I was proud to be part of that effort. We saved branch libraries. They're going to close a bunch of them. First it was 6 or 7 or 8, and then it was 4. We kept saying no. We minimized layoffs in the down economy. We saved jobs. We've done a lot to be proud of. You look at the dysfunction in D.C., and it wasn't too long ago people would say, geez, that city council is a circus down there. My God. You know what? We've got a good group of people who don't always get along in every issue. We have varied talents and varied interests, and we've made some great headway for the people we represent. It's an honor for me to be one of the 4 at-large city councilors. I know my place. I know I've been a good leader for the council. I also know that I've brought my financial acumen to bear and been helpful to the city during all my years as city councilor. And I'm asking for your support, and I'm asking you to consider all of my at-large incumbent colleagues. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you. Ms. Pressley.
Good evening. My name is Ayanna Pressley. It has been my humbling honor to serve as one of your 4 at-large Boston City Councilors for the last 2 years. I love being an at-large Boston City Councilor. I get to actualize my values every day. Not many people can say that. I think people erroneously regard municipal government as the bottom rung of power, but this is the form of government closest to you, and so it is the most important. In broad strokes, my work is about breaking poverty and violence cycles. If you Google me, you'll find the knock against me is that that agenda is too broad and too big for municipal government. I reject that notion. If Congress has a monopoly on big, hard issues, I think they could use our help. I really do believe that these issues are germane to municipal government. I'm a strong advocate on behalf of issues uniquely impacting women and girls. I don't believe there's any such thing as women's issues. And advocating to stabilize our families, because that's what makes our communities healthy. And I mean every family, whether you're 2 mommies, 2 daddies, a single parented household, a family of one. It is incumbent upon us to make sure this city works for every family, for people in the dawn of their life and also in the twilight. Quickly, some of my accomplishments. I'm overhauled with Councilor Connolly a dated policy on BPS books supporting pregnant and parenting teens. It hasn't been updated since 1989. It's the number one reason our girls drop out of school. It costs this Commonwealth $7,000 a year annually for every child born to a teen mom. That child is 4 times more likely to be incarcerated. That's $300,000 in lost revenue and tax base over the course of their life. Secondly, I convened the first ever listening-only hearing in the Boston City Council to listen to 300 families impacted by homicide in the city, and that resulted in programmatic and procedural changes by law enforcement and providers to break cycles of violence. And I do believe these issues, we have a moral imperative to work on them, but again, there is an economic impact. And I hope you will honor me on November 8th with one of your 4 votes so I can continue to do this hard but good work. Thank you very much.
Thank you all for coming and allowing us to share our ideas with you. It's a real honor to be here, and I just want to remind everybody that November 8th is the day, and I'm number 7 on the ballot, Sean Ryan from Jamaica Plain. I'm a school teacher, and I'm trying to fix the schools. It may seem as though I disagree with some of the other candidates on more issues than they disagree with anybody else, but I'm not just disagreeing to disagree. I do think that there's room on the council for somebody who's more fiscally conservative. I do think that there's room on the council for someone who's willing to say no if they disagree with the policies being offered. I'm focusing on the 3 S's. Those are schools, services, and safety. I think I've made it very clear what sort of approach I take to the schools. I want to cater to parents' preferences, and I'm aware that many parents want neighborhood schools. That's why I'm supporting it. With regard to safety, I'm trying to point out that drug and violence prevention policies that we've had for about 40 years, it's sometimes referred to as a war on drugs, that this policy has failed. And in fact, it's not a war on drugs. We don't send the drugs to prison. We send our inner city men to prison, and we break up families, and we create social problems that then get transferred into the schools, and that the schools are not the proper vehicle to solve. No matter how many Band-Aids we put on the school system, until we address the root causes of these issues, we're not going to make permanent progress. And my services platform, Doing More With Less, is just me pointing out that we have less money as a society, we have less money in our city and in our communities, and it doesn't make sense for the government to take more of our money when we have less. That is an unsustainable way of funding city government. School services and safety, I'm Sean Ryan from Jamaica Plain. I humbly ask for one of your four votes on November the 8th. I'm number 7 on the ballot. And even if I have to run 7 times, this message will be heard, and we will make progress on the schools as well as on the safety issues. Thank you very much for your time. I hope I've convinced you to just consider me for one of your four. Thank you.
Thank you.
And I thank you, Mr. Arroyo.
Thanks for trying, Peter. Why don't I just go by Felix?
Hey, Arroyo.
Okay. Much better on a second time.
You've got to give me a second chance.
All right. I think I just lost a minute on that, but at least I can run that up. My name is Felix Arroyo. I'm one of your four at-large city councilors, and I feel privileged and honored to serve you in that role. In 2 minutes, I would like to go over the leadership role that I played in saving our branch libraries, the leadership role that I played in selling the firefighters contract to the tune of saving the city $43 million based on the arbitration decision that was granted, the leadership role that I played in restoring thousands upon thousands of youth summer jobs and helping to fully fund year-round jobs. But I also want to spend some time talking about issues more important and close to home, because I also believe a city council, while doing those things, as I did, should also focus on quality of life issues as they relate to the people living in this city. The reason I was just a little bit late, it's not politician time, it was as I was at City Hall convening a hearing on bus idling on our streets, and the fact that we have a law on bus idling that is never enforced. I also am proud to be working with Representative Marty Walls, who's here, and with City Councilor Michael Ross, who's here, on the question of commercial trash pickup times. Yeah. If you live in a downtown neighborhood, you know they come well after 11 o'clock. And you know that when they show up, you can't fall asleep. I have filed a home rule petition that mirrors very much what Representative Walls filed at the State House, and I filed it with Michael Ross that says we want to regulate the times that you do commercial trash pickup in the city, because we understand that residents live in these downtown neighborhoods. And lastly, I'll mention, I take the groundwater issue so serious that I asked Council President Murphy to appoint me to the Groundwater Trust, and we have been a faithful member of that Groundwater Trust, and I understand how important that is in this neighborhood, and it's serious to me as an at-large city councilor. I'll wrap up by asking you to please consider giving me one of your four votes on November 8th. I am so honored that you came to even listen. You should be commended for the time you're spending here. Thank you for your time. Again, my name is Felix Arroyo.
Thank you, Felix. John Connolly.
Thanks for the opportunity to come before you tonight and say I'm John Connolly. I'm a former teacher. I've taught children in every neighborhood of this city, just as important work with parents from every neighborhood of this city. When I go to City Hall every day for 4 years now, I am focused on improving and supporting our Boston public schools. When I found out that we were serving expired food to our kids, I went into the schools, found out it was happening, food frozen up to and beyond 2 years in some cases, and I did what a city councilor is supposed to do. I brought it to light, I held an investigation, I conducted hearings, found it was going on in 40 plus schools, and now it's ended, and our children are being given fresher and healthier food, and we've saved money. I've led the effort to raise our dropout age from 16 to 18. I was the only city councilor who went to the State House to testify in favor of the education reform bill that Representative Walls championed and has made the biggest difference for young people in this city in the longest time. I held a first of its kind hearing on the Boston teachers contract, not to demonize teachers or blame teachers, but simply to say that when the teachers union and BPS go behind closed doors, parents and students lose their voice. That's why we have the shortest school day in the United States, comparatively speaking. It's why teacher evaluation was an optional exercise, and it's why we lose amazing art teachers simply because they don't have enough seniority. I also joined Mike Ross, who's been the real leader here, on trying to bring a school downtown, and I support his efforts on that fully. Whether you have kids who will ever be in the Boston Public Schools or not, you need these schools to work, because great schools equal great neighborhoods and a great future for this city. I hope you've got room for one of your four votes for an education counselor, because that's what I do every day.
Thank you very much, Will Dorcena.
Hi, my name is William Dorcena. I'm number one on the ballot when you walk into that booth. On Tuesday, November 8th, I would definitely appreciate one of your four votes. Boston is often described as a city on a hill, a city that would be a model for the rest of the world to follow. I say we are not a city on a hill when a story like mine is too rare a story versus the everyday story. We can be a city on a hill, but it will take real bold leadership in order to get there. I am not afraid to challenge entrenched views, and I would work every single day and to do what's right on behalf of the taxpayers. We have some really big fights ahead of us. The number one fight, I think, the casino legislation. In the fine print, it says only the ward in which a casino is located will have the power to object to that casino being located in that ward. Suffolk Downs, Ward 1, City of Boston. So only Ward 1 can have a say as to whether or not Las Vegas Boulevard will be 10 minutes from here in the Back Bay. It makes absolutely no sense whatsoever. So I think we need to fight that. I think we as a city need to stand up and say this legislation does not work for all of us because, I mean, the North End and Charlestown share city council with Ward 1, never mind the rest of us throughout the city. My daughter is 2 years old. Her name is Madison. And I say there is no way I'm going to let her be 20, look her in the eye, and know that I didn't do everything I could in my power to make sure her 18 years are better than my years growing up. And so I'm fed up with the shenanigans, with the politics, and I've decided to stand up and speak truth every single day and fight hard to do what's right on behalf of the taxpayer. I'm a very cynical person. I was telling a person earlier, when the elected officials come knock on my door, I give them a really hard time because I ask them a lot of questions. And so I welcome you to ask me many of those same difficult questions. I think we need new leadership in the city, and I would provide that. Thank you.
Thank you. Michael Flower.
Thank you, Peter. Let me just say that it's great to be here, and I want to thank you all for taking time out of your schedules from the North End, South End, Back Bay, Beacon Hill, and the West End. All great neighborhoods, all neighborhoods that I've had the privilege and the honor of serving as your city council, as your council president, also as a former prosecutor, as an assistant district attorney, and as a candidate for mayor in Boston. I'm excited to be in this race. This is a great opportunity to pick up and talk about the issues that we've had conversations about in the past. I left a very comfortable seat on the Boston City Council. Served the council with a class and distinction. Would have most likely topped the ticket had I, like I did in the previous three elections. But for me, it's never been about being comfortable. It's about making our city better. And you're talking about, and I'm looking at some of the highest taxpayers in the city of Boston, yet you don't always get the respect that you need as a resident and as a neighborhood. You're looking at someone that will be a strong, consistent, independent fighter and voice for the people of our city, all of our neighborhoods, not just some of our neighborhoods. I recognize from talking to people throughout the course of this campaign is that Boston is not working for everyone. Folks did not get the school of their choice. People lost a loved one to senseless violence. Some neighborhoods resemble shooting galleries. A lot of people in our city are out of work. I intend to go to city council and roll up the sleeves to make a difference, working with colleagues and working with the administration if it means it's in the best interest of the city of Boston. But folks, keep in mind that we have a mayor that is actively talking about running for a sixth four-year term. Don't laugh. He's actively talking about a sixth. Now more than ever, we need a strong, independent voice in the city council. That's not going to appear once a year or quarterly or around election time, but every single day, every single week on the floor of the council. The role of the city council is to serve as the city's checks and balances. It's the last bastion to checks and balances. It requires seven votes. Getting seven people to agree with you as your neighbors, we can make a difference in the city of Boston. Thank you for your time and attention. Love to have you vote November 8th. Michael Flaherty.
Thank you very much.
If I may make just a concluding comment, David Jacobs, who's publisher of the Koran, made a comment to me referring to you as the Magnificent Seven. There is a seventh person there, but he had to leave early for another commitment. You truly are a Magnificent Seven, and you make our vote mean so meaningful. It's just a treat to have the opportunity to moderate the conversation with you people. And I thank you for your time, and I really thank you for living within the time limits. I want to turn this over to Rob Whitney, and here I also want to make a comment. We as a community have to appreciate all the hard work that Rob has put to coordinate this effort. And so I turn to you and I say thank you very much.
Thank you all so much. I'm a board member of the Beacon Hill Civic Association, which is one of the sponsors, and I wanted to thank you all for coming. It was a great turnout tonight. I think it's our biggest turnout in 8 years tonight. I wanted to thank again the Park Street School and the head of school, Tracy Bradley, for allowing us to use their facility. Thanks again to Peter Neston. I think it's not Magnificent Seven, it's the Magnificent Eight, including Peter. Thanks very much for Peter's great job again. Thanks again to all the candidates. They did a great job answering some tough questions, I think. And we got some very serious responses. No sound bites, real interesting responses to real issues. And on behalf of all the Boston neighborhoods that sponsored this evening's event, I wish you all a good evening. Thank you.